Howdy folks, got a few projects upcoming. Wanted to make an introduction to a few of them. You can see I've got a couple of refrigerators on the trailer back here. And one of them belongs to a friend. It's an old GE monitor top with the compressor system mounted on top of the unit. And then the other one is another Frigidaire, which I got a real good deal on. And the Frigidaire was supposedly, I believe, working, but then put in storage a long time and the core deteriorated. So that one will need some rewiring. The monitor top is going to need some work on the refrigerant system. It's got a hole in the line at the evaporator. And in case you're wondering what all this discoloration is, that is what happens when a refrigerator plows through a swarm of gnats at 70 to 75 miles an hour. And obviously the gnats lose when that happens. Next item is a Buffalo Forge Brizo fan. And I don't really know how old it is. Got a nice GE motor on there. But I decided against any pre-repair startup attempts with this one. It does have a capacitor box here. Original capacitor in there. And obviously I see a lot of like paint residue, paint overspray residue. Makes me think this was used as a paint booth fan. Bearings are still good in it. The little flip cap oilers. So yeah, this is going to be a future project. I don't know when I'm going to try to work on it. I've got a lot of other things going on too. The monitor top fridge, its refrigerant system was developed a leak, and that one uses sulfur dioxide gas for its refrigerant, and that can become corrosive if moisture gets in there. So the first thing I'm going to do is try to get that system sealed up and vacuumed. Pull all that out and get all the air and moisture out. From that point, there won't be any more deterioration, so I'll have a little more time. All right, folks, I got both the fridges unloaded safely using the overhead hoist, and get a little bit closer detail of the problem with the monitor top. You can actually see there's still some gas escaping. See the bubbles? I'm sure that's because of me handling it, moving it around, caused something that was dissolved in the oil to come out of a solution, and that's why that's doing that. But this one worked and cooled. That's just that's the only thing wrong, as far as I know, with it mechanically. And someone in the past, previous owner, had taken the top off and turned it around the wrong way, because this part is supposed to be on the back, and the controls and everything on the front. So I have to pull that off and turn it around. And once again, this belongs to my friend Andrew, and he's going to do all the cosmetic restoration. So I'm just going to get this the leak point in here fixed and get it working again. You can see this cord, understandably, is not serviceable. And we had put a temporary test cord on there, and like I said, got it running and it cooled. So all I got to do is fix the leak and charge it up, and I'm going to go back with R152A. That seems to be proven based on the forum, and get it going. But first, I'm going to check out the Frigidaire a little bit too. This one I found on Craigslist, another one from down near New Orleans. And it has the wider super freezer chest system. A lot more room in there for things in the freezer. And it's another enamel, glass enamel coated cabinet. This one I'm going to try to do a little restoration on the hardware too. So it's taken some sea salt air from South Louisiana. Of course, we got the gnats all over there from driving down the road last night after dark. But what I want to do first, I want to try to see what I've got, so to speak. And obviously this cable is just crispy and worthless. So first thing I'm going to do is try to rewire the compressor only, and maybe get the start relay fixed. That way I can just have the motor protector and the circuit from this and run the unit and see, you know, if it works, if it's charged, if there's hope for it, so to speak. And it looks like this thing might have been in a low level of flooding. I don't think it got up to the cabinet where the insulation would be wet, but, you know, this looks kind of like it's been in muddy water. So once we get the old wiring out, I'll take it out there and pressure wash underneath it and come back. Well, I removed that completely hideous, atrocious wiring. As you can see, that would have just not been anything that I would have cared to try to use. Even up under here, it's all just hard and crispy. It's just cutting it with wire cutters. You hear the crumbliness? Yeah, that's no good. Now, before anybody freaks out, that oil is penetrating oil I used to get the terminal caps off without putting too much pressure on anything and causing a leak to start. So all of the electrics that I'm planning to reuse I've removed, and now I'm going to go wash this and come back. All right, the moment of truth is fast approaching for the Frigidaire. I have rewired the compressor, put a new set of lead wires to it. I have it wired up with a test cord directly to the start relay. There will be no thermostat, so if it runs, it'll run continuously like this, just for a test of the system. Now I am going to do a insulation check on the compressor motor. This is going to give me a 500 volt insulation check, and I'm going from the cord to the body of the compressor. Got 22 mega ohms at 500 volt, so I consider that safe to test. And then got the trusty old kilowatt meter. Make sure all this is on screen here. So now once again, this is the first time I have not tried to run this yet. This is going to be the first attempt. So here goes nothing. All right. Oh, something's wrong. Sounds like the start winding's kicking back in. All right, I shut it down. I'm gonna check the relay out. I bet something's going wrong in there. Okay, I've got the relay disassembled. So there's the relay with the cover off, and I'm gonna run the motor again and see if the start contact is kicking back in after it started. Yep, see the sparking? So that tells me right there that relay is in need of repair. Now I'm still going to play with it, try to get it to work for now, just for a test of the compressor. So let me do some adjustment on the contacts and come right back. Did some tweaking on the contacts. We'll see if it's going to kick out the start winding this time and stay running. .86 amps. Doesn't sound so bad. Sounds like refrigerant. Yeah, it's definitely cooling. All right, let it run for a while. All right, I'm gonna try to get connected to the service port on the CK monitor top. It's not like anything that you see nowadays. Got a metal cap. And so the way this port works, there's not a Schrader valve or any kind of check valve in there. There's actually a couple of plugs. And this first plug, I think, is more or less just for protection. And you take that out. And then there's a second plug down in there that is the actual stop valve. And the tool fits over this. It's a fairly large tool, and it allows you to put a wrench down into that stop valve plug and take it out with it still contained inside the tool, and that allows the refrigerant gas to flow. One of the first things I'm going to do is clean it up with a little wire brush on a Dremel tool like that, because I don't want that rust to get into my vacuum pump or into any of the lines or the compressor. So I'm going to spare you all the noise and do that off camera, and then come back and discuss it a little bit more. I share my videos with a lot of people with different technical backgrounds, and this may be boring to some folks, but I wanted to explain the service port situation. I just cleaned that service port and got it where there's not rust on it. Well, a lot of my car buddies are familiar with this gauge, this set of gauges. This is for automotive R134A systems, and it's a quick connect, almost like an air hose. You just pull that ring back, and the port on the vehicle looks like that. And you just, it's easier with two hands, lock it on there, open the valve, and then you service the system. And pretty much all cars made with air conditioning since the mid-90s, I believe, that have the R134A system use this connection. Then those of us who are a little older and been in the car business, we'll all remember this system. It uses a quarter inch port and a fitting with a little deal inside that presses a Schrader valve. And this valve will seal itself off when you disconnect the hose, and you just have to put a cap on there to cover it up after you're done. And this gauge set is a little more modern. It actually has a check valve in here, so when you tighten it up on the fitting, it opens a valve in the hose and a valve in the fitting at the same time, and you get flow. When you take it off, this valve closes, and it keeps you from losing refrigerant trapped in the hose, and it also keeps your hoses clean. So this fit like my 72 Chevy Nova. This system fit house AC R22 system. But what I'm going to show you now is the service valve for the monitor top. And I consider myself very fortunate to have been able to get this, because I assure you, none of these have been sold new in probably the last, 40 years. But this kit is complete and even has extra stuff in it. The previous owner must have been a tradesman, and he had some extra things in here. But this is the tool for actually opening the caps down inside the service valve. It's a Bristol type spline. It looks like a Torx, but it's not. It's slightly different. So the way you use this kit, first you're going to take the little wrench and put it into the dust cover screw. And then you have a hand wheel that fits on here, and you can take out the dust cover screw. And then the next step is to put this adapter over the service valve. And there's a seal that goes in here which is missing out of the kit. That's the one thing I'm missing. So you have this on the fitting with this inside it, ready to take out the second plug. And when the second plug is released, that's when the refrigerant gas is open. Then this tool, valve body with the hand wheel, there's actually a wrench inside, the socket wrench, which will, you push it down and engage it with this tool to take out the inner plug and let the gas flow. So it's stacked together like this on the service valve. With the wrench inside there. And you can take out the inner plug that opens the valve and lets the refrigerant out. And once again, I'm missing a couple of seals that go with this kit, but otherwise it's complete and has extra adapters that the guy had. So it was a very fortunate find. My first Frigidaire that I repaired, I never figured I'd get a kit like this, and I drilled out that port and put a modern style one in there, which allowed this gauge set to be used. But the monitor top is a lot more valuable of an antique, and we don't want to do anything to it like that. And it's going to look and function like it did originally. We're going to keep the float valve system and pretty much everything stock except the refrigerant gas. We're not going to go back with SO2. So get this thing put on there and try to see if I got all the right adapters like I think I do. Now, I don't pretend to be an expert on this. This is the first one of these monitor tops I've dealt with, and I may have to backtrack and say that I told you something wrong toward the end of the videos on this, but at this point I'm learning as I go and doing a lot of research as I go. So y'all hope you enjoy learning along with me, and in the end we should have a running antique fridge. Alright, first thing I'm going to do is take out this the outer dust cap plug, put the wrench in there like so. I had put penetrating oil on it earlier and then cleaned it with a brake cleaner and blown it with compressed air to make sure no dirt fell down inside there. So that's the first plug out. Down inside there, you can actually see the second plug with holes drilled in it. There's three holes down inside the Bristol key area. And that's where the refrigerant can flow once that plug is loosened. So the next stage is going to be to put the adapter on, but I want to put a seal under it first. I don't have the copper or lead seal that probably came with the kit, so I'm going to try an O-ring. And from the looks of it, this adapter is the one that got used the most. It's got a lot of almost looks like pipe wrench marks on it. I'd be ashamed to do that to this nice nickel-plated brass kit, but you know, some people have their own way of doing things. That one looks a little bit too long. Maybe not. There's a longer one of these too, but we'll try this one and see what happens. Now, once it's all tight, you push that part down and connect it to that plug and take it out. So put that on. Move the camera back where it's a little more visual there. So like that, it's free, push it down. I'm engaged in the plug, and then I can tighten this packing nut to seal it in case it leaks around here, and put the hand wheel on. I believe that is the complete stack up for the service kit, minus the seal that's supposed to be in here. But at this point I'm not too concerned about it because I'm not actually going to try to evacuate it. Then when the time comes, take this this set of gauges that has the standard quarter inch fitting on it, put it on there like so, and then use my normal vacuum pump and charging tools for it. And once again, this unit leaked, so there's probably not a lot of pressure, but I'm going to try to open it and see if anything comes out. Well, it's tight. I don't want to break it. Yeah, that's very tight. I don't know if it's corroded down in there or if it's just been sitting so long. I'm going to take this back off. One of the good aspects of this kit is there's two of these bits in there. So I hope I don't damage anything, but if it does happen, I will have a spare. not be completely out of luck. There's the spare right there. Now I'm going to try a tap wrench to see if I can get some bite on that safely. And I'm going to try to break it loose without the rest of that valve on there. There it went. I just didn't want to put all that stress on this valve stem and risk breaking this tool, because I know I probably will never find another one. Oh, it worked. I heard some gas come out. So that's on there. And it works, yay. So I know most of the SO2 leaked out already, but in order for me to repair the evaporator leak, I would need to have the system fully discharged. So I will deal with the rest of that SO2. And then when I have a chance, we'll come back and try to solder it. So yeah, getting excited. One thing I can say about SO2, people are afraid of it, and it is nasty. It has just a horrendous smell to it, and it's an irritant. But because it is so bad smelling, you're not going to inadvertently spend too much time breathing it and get poisoned, because the smell is so bad, you will get out of there. The only way I could see someone getting seriously hurt was if they somehow got trapped in an area with a major leak and could not get out. But if this happened and leaked out in your home, you would know it, and you definitely would not stay in there. So I would not be too worried about it. But in the end, this one's going to have R152A, just due to availability. All right, this has been running for about half an hour now. Current's gone up to 1.89 amps, which means it's working. A little bit warm there. That's iced, frosted all the way. Yep. See the vapor? I blew my breath in there. That is definitely working well. The compressor is healthy. So the next step on this one will just be rewiring. Well, I took the cooling unit off the cabinet, thanks to the Harbor Freight hoist. Get a closer look at this damage. What actually happened, that solder that they used is just debonded from the evaporator. See how it's moving there? So we have to get that cleaned up and redone, and hopefully that's going to stop the leak permanently. But looking at this unit itself, it really looks to be in pretty good shape. I mean, this isn't deteriorated, so it's not been all wet. So I think we'll get this fixed and probably be good as new. Well, I got the damaged part out. You can see that was just barely in there, and the solder really looks like it might have been a cold joint. I've got to get some of the proper solder, like the Stay-Brite 8 solder for this. So it's going to sit like that for now. But I did start on the rewiring job. As you can see, that wiring is getting pretty crispy. Start relay looks pretty good. Might need a little cleaning. And on this side, the thermostat looks like it's not in bad shape. I didn't see any damage to the capillary tube. Once again, you know, the wiring is pretty toasty. Try to get a view inside there. So I'm going to pull a new wire through and try to get it wired back up with some type MTW, high temperature wire that's a little better than this. It won't be a cord like that. It'll be three individual wires, but I'll put sleeving around it so it'll look kind of legitimate. Doesn't look like this thing's been wet on the inside. But one thing I can say, I'm really impressed with the engineering that went into it, because it's truly unlike anything that you have currently. And everything about it is over-engineered. They really definitely were at a pinnacle of refrigeration technology with this. The only way I think that they improved in the future was to go from this to the cap tube. This design with a capillary tube, I think, would probably be about as refined as you can get. So I'm going to get on with the rewiring job and move on from there. But I've had this Frigidaire running without the thermostat today for about the last 2 hours. Fully frosted, whole thing, so I think we're good on this one. Motor current draw. Sounds like new. So the wiring harness is done and put in. I've got it terminated here on the start relay, and the switch is on the other side. I'm going to do an insulation resistance test with a 500 volt test voltage. So 122 mega ohms at 500 volts. I think that is a pretty good insulation condition. So I may have already said this once, but I don't have the correct type of solder to do this repair now. So maybe tomorrow I'll be able to get what I need to finish that. And also I want to get a three-wire grounded cord and tie it into this and get it buttoned back up. I'm afraid I wanted to pull vacuum today and get the last of the SO2 out for corrosion reasons. But I'm afraid anything I put on here might suck into the evaporator from the vacuum. So I'm just going to have to wait on that. Got it all taped up. And on the Frigidaire, I've let the compressor run for probably 2 hours, which is way longer than a normal cycle. And it's barely warm. There's plenty of ice on the evaporator. Everything looks great on this one. So we're going to shut it down and listen to the spin down time. All right, so pretty much success today. Wish I'd had the solder, but that's a minor issue at this point.